It's unmistakable, rising up like a castle from the rolling prairie, the gold leaf statue of the angel Moroni adorning its main spire. The new Mormon temple in Kansas City symbolizes a rare pattern at a time when many faiths see their numbers in North America shrinking.
Of the church worldwide, about 6.5 million members of the church in the United States.
And for members of the church, this is the house of the Lord.
We were shown around by Elder William Walker, a top church official who oversees the operation of 137 temples worldwide, with 30 more on the way.
How much did it cost to build this?
A lot.
He won't say how much, but it doesn't look like any expense was spared. The chambers are striking. We saw ceiling rooms where weddings take place, an instruction room with a mural depicting Earth as Mormons believe just after creation, and the pristine celestial room, the most sacred space inside, for reflection and meditation, complete with crystal chandeliers. This is the biggest room you'll find in the temple. There's no large sanctuary.
The purpose of the temple is not for a big meeting. We have other chapels and throughout the church and throughout the world, assembly halls and meeting halls. And when we come to the temple, this is more for private and individual communion.
While we were given an extensive tour, the church denied our request to record it and instead provided these pictures. I asked Walker if that doesn't play into perceptions, right or wrong, that the church is secretive.
It's not about secret, it's about sacred. And we feel that it's a very sacred and a special place and therefore is reserved for those worship functions and those ordinances that take place in the temple. Is not about secret.
Come on in, out of the way.
But once the temple closes its doors to the public next month, not even all Mormons will be allowed in.
Worshippers are supposed to wear white when they come in here on a normal basis. During these visits, we have to wear foot coverings so we don't mess up the carpets. Now, once this place is dedicated, you cannot come past this front desk, what's called the recommend desk, unless you have a recommendation from your local Mormon church leader.
Inside, the ornate baptismal font resting on 12 oxen, symbolizing the 12 tribes of Israel. But the font also symbolizes controversy for the LDS Church. Here, they'll perform hundreds of posthumous baptisms, specifically for Mormons' ancestors who were not of the faith, an invitation to accept Mormonism as an avenue into heaven. But some Mormons have used the church's genealogy database to baptize others who are not Mormon ancestors, like murdered Jewish reporter Daniel Pearl and Holocaust victims like Anne Frank, a practice that has outraged Jewish leaders.
The critics say that this speaks of a theological arrogance and intolerance, that you believe your faith is the only avenue in which to get into heaven. What do you say to that?
Well, I would say to that, Jesus didn't say this is just for people of a particular persuasion. Jesus taught it's necessary to be baptized to enter the kingdom of heaven.
Walker says there's no desire to offend anyone. He says the church views this as a loving, kind gesture, but is cracking down on those who violate their policy.
When I asked him how he would respond to those who say the damage is done, that too many people have already been offended by posthumous baptisms, Elder Walker said maybe we didn't do some things as well as we should have. He said we would tell them we're sorry, but we live by our word when we say we'll do something about it.